Tanta Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Winter Wishes by Elle Adams, narrated by Helen Langford. Chapter 1. The Holiday Haven Inn was open for business, and we were always ready for the occasion. I stood on a stepladder, affixing a banner over the door to the hall, which said, 5 years of festive cheer. Genuine snowflakes drifted from the ceiling, while the large Christmas tree in the corner remained up all year round, decorated with glittering baubles. Snow dusted the front desk of the reception area, tinsel adorned the windowsills, and everything sparkled with festivity. This weekend marked 5 years since my best friend and I had flown, literally, up to the North Pole to start anew in Holiday Haven. So we'd opted to host a major event to celebrate. Perhaps we'd gone a little overboard with the decorations, but everyone in Holiday Haven knew how to get into the spirit of the season. In an enchanted town where Christmas was celebrated every day, no matter the time of year, you kind of had to. Behind the desk, Mercy hung up the phone, tucking a strand of her curly dark hair behind her ear. A thick red scarf was wrapped around her neck, matching the rest of her red and white ensemble, and she came over to join me next to the stepladder I stood on in order to reach the right spot above the door and finish putting the banner into place.
Nice job, Carol.
Thanks. I smiled up at the glittering banner, which I'd spelled so that the letters glowed in the dark. I rarely use those spells these days, but it was one of the more useful skills I'd inherited from my parents. Possibly the only one, in fact. Entrepreneurial spirit ran in my family too, but it had been Mercy who'd masterminded our whole scheme to move to the North Pole to begin with. Even that sounded saner than some of the schemes my family had come up with, including the part where we'd moved into an abandoned shack and converted it into an inn for guests from out of town. But we'd built a successful business over the past 5 years, and I allowed myself a moment of pride for what we'd accomplished. Despite appearances, it wasn't my festive name which had contributed to our decision to move here. I might not have wintry magic like Mercy did, but I loved the Christmas holidays, always had. Not the damp and drizzly winters we got back in England, but the sort with actual snow and enough of it to build a village of snowmen and go sledging or ice skating every weekend. Holiday Haven had all that and more.
I sorted out the ads, Mercy said. We have a double-page spread in the papers and will be on the front page of Hark the Herald tomorrow.
Awesome, I said. What about the entertainment? Did the carolers get back to you?
They did, she said. As expected, they said yes right away. Let's face it, they'll perform to an audience of inanimate snowmen if nobody else is around. Anyway, they've agreed to sing during the interludes of the play and to stand outside while we're welcoming people inside.
Perfect. We'd also successfully convinced the town's biggest theatre company to put on an exclusive performance at the inn this upcoming Saturday. They'd been rehearsing for weeks, and while we'd hit a few minor hitches in the process, we'd also sold half the tickets already. Adding the town's enthusiastic carolers to our programme would only increase the appeal. A flutter of wings sounded when a large owl swooped through the window and dropped off a package in the reception area before departing the inn.
Expecting a delivery? I asked.
Yes! She scooted over to the door and retrieved the square package before setting it down on the desk. Then she undid several layers of secure wrapping to reveal a smaller box, inset with glittering gemstones and with a narrow slot in the side. I studied the box when she held it up to show me. Am I supposed to know what that is?
You know how we had trouble figuring out how to make everyone happy with the presents in Santa's grotto?
She asked, her blue eyes twinkling.
This is a genuine wishing box.
Seriously? I asked. Where did you find it?
I ordered it from a specialist shop back home in England. Took me long enough to find one.
She placed the box onto the desk again.
I've never used one before, but I'm told it's fairly straightforward. Anyone who wants to use the box just needs to write their wish on a piece of paper and then put it into the box. Then it works its magic and...
She snapped her fingers and a few snowflakes drifted down onto the desk.
Wow, I said. Can you literally ask the box for anything? Within reason. I was going to give it a test run first.
Wise idea. I mean, what happens if a kid wishes they owned a giant robot dinosaur? That could get weird pretty fast.
Her brow crinkled.
Good point.
We can't control what people wish for either, I added. Like, if someone wishes the sky was green or that we all lived underwater, would the box try to make that happen?
We can work from a list instead. The kids will ask for toys while the adults will ask for fancy cars or houses.
My brows shot up. Do we want random houses falling out of the sky? As for cars, sledges were the favoured mode of transport here in Holiday Haven, and for good reason. The ever-present snow on the roads all year round made driving a risky venture.
Hmm, she looked at the box dubiously. Good point. I think it works by adjusting the circumstances so you end up with what you wish for, but there must be a limit somewhere.
Not that I'm trying to dampen your idea, I added hastily. Just thinking ahead in case someone decides to wish for something inadvisable and all hell breaks loose.
The last thing we needed was for our weekend celebration to be derailed if someone decided to wish for world domination or something. I'd grown up surrounded by so much weirdness that imagining what one of my family members might have done if they'd got hold of a wishing box was enough to make me reluctant to hand it over to the public. On the other hand, if we were careful to check that no wish was likely to result in any trouble, then what harm could it do?
I'll test the box out later, she said. Also, I'll keep it hidden until the main event so that we don't give away the surprise.
Good idea. I can see Janice getting a wishing box of her own just to try to compete with us. Janice, who owned the only other Holiday Inn in our part of town, was forever trying to undercut us and take away our potential customers. It annoyed her to no end that we'd put together such a big event at short notice, and I wouldn't put it past her to swipe the idea for her own at the first opportunity. It certainly wouldn't be the first time she'd done so. Still, I was confident the wishing box would prove a hit with our guests, especially as it was the real deal. Most people would be clamouring to get in line to have the chance to make their own wishes come true.
Yeah, I wouldn't put it past her, said Mercy. I know for a fact that she's still mad because we snagged the best theatre group in town.
Too right. I walked behind the desk to the wooden door leading into the back room, which we'd converted from a supply closet to a backstage area the theatre group could use as a changing room between acts, since another door inside the room connected it to the hall where the main performance would be taking place. I entered the hall, surveying the wide stage we'd set up for the production. Rows of chairs filled the rest of the space, while tinsel hung in loops from the walls. 4 days remained until the main event kicked off, and now all we needed was an audience. I pushed some chairs into line, hearing Mercy's voice from the reception area talking to someone. A moment later, she entered the hall and beckoned me over, her usual cheer notably absent from her expression.
Carol, some guests just showed up. They look a bit... odd.
My brow furrowed. We're at the North Pole in a town inhabited by elves, abominable snowmen, and talking animals. What's too odd for Holiday Haven?
Come on, she said, looking decidedly uncomfortable. Judge for yourself.
Wondering what had her tinsel in a tangle, I walked after her into the reception area via the back room. We still have enough rooms for guests, don't we?
Of course. That's not the problem.
Then what could possibly be odd about... them? I trailed off, looking in horror at my own parents, who stood in the lobby next to a collection of large suitcases. Both of them were short and blonde, like me, though their thickest winter coats were bright where I tended to wear dark colours. What set us apart, though, was on their heads. Mum wore a giant red hat decorated with silver tinsel and glittering fairy lights, while Dad wore a bright green one, decked out like a Christmas tree. Even Mum's tabby cat Charlie wore a miniature red hat between his pointed ears. That was the family business, novelty hats, and boy had I seen enough hat-related nonsense for a lifetime. Why had they come all the way up to the North Pole for an unexpected visit this week of all possible weeks? Even by the standards of Holiday Haven, they stood out, and everyone in town would have noticed their arrival.
Oh, hello, Carolyn.
Mum's hat bounced on her forehead, its lights flashing, while I silently debated the feasibility of booking them a last-minute flight to the South Pole instead, or going there myself. The only person who didn't wear a hat was my sister Bella, who sloped in behind them wearing a plain beige coat and looking about as enthused about their visit as I did. Mum's hat came close to toppling off her head as she bobbed around in excitement, taking in the stack of brochures in the reception area and the 5 years of festive cheer sign hanging over the door to the main hall.
Is that real snow?
Looks that way, Dad said.
It's great to see you, sweetheart.
His hat burst into a loud rendition of O Christmas Tree. Bella's expression of utter mortification matched my own, and I wished, well, if I opened that wishing box right now, I'd probably wish to turn myself into a tree ornament for the duration of their visit.
Please tell me they aren't staying until the weekend.
Given their track record of unintentionally embarrassing their children, the odds of them not derailing the event were about as good as the abominable snowman developing a taste for tanning on the beach.
Why, universe, why?
Hey, Mum and Dad. I tried to inject enthusiasm into my tone, or at least sound less horrified. But there was a reason we'd hired actual actors to take part in our play. I couldn't believe my family had come all this way without giving me warning first, or that Bella had let them. She hated cold weather, and was disdainful at best towards the holiday season. Imagine Scrooge as a 20-year-old blonde, and you'll get the picture. Why had she thought my parents' visit was a good idea, much less willingly come with them? Silently apologising for being the worst daughter on the planet, I drew in a breath before lying through my teeth.
Sorry, we have an event this weekend and all our rooms will be taken.
I heard you, said Bella. You do have spare rooms.
Thanks for that, Bella.
Honestly, I'd have thought she'd have leapt on the chance to fly back home. What had Mum and Dad bribed her with to convince her to join them?
We have one spare room, I corrected myself. It's right above the reception area, in which you'll be able to hear Christmas music playing from early in the morning until night.
Bella's nose wrinkled.
One room.
One suite, said Mercy. Two beds. You three will have to share a room, I'm afraid.
I hoped Bella would flat out refuse, but no such luck.
Fine.
I tried to catch her eye, wanting to ask why on earth she'd let Mum and Dad drag her all the way up here, when we both knew she'd rather be partying on a beachfront instead. Did she really miss me that much? I sincerely doubted it.
Perfect, Mum beamed. We'll take it. We'll be staying for a week, right?
I think we're leaving Monday morning, said Dad, who'd always been the slightly more organised of the pair of them, despite living in the same slightly offbeat dream world as Mum did.
What was that about an event this weekend?
I hid a grimace as Mum's familiar, Charlie, knocked a bauble off the tree and began playing with it.
Yes, Mercy and I are celebrating 5 years of running our holiday inn.
Has it really been that long? Mum asked. To think we haven't come up to visit before now. We're long overdue.
I've come to see you at least once per year, though.
It wasn't as though I didn't call them regularly, either. It would have been nice if they'd at least mentioned their plans during our last chat, before showing up here. I don't remember when we last talked about you coming to visit.
Nor me, said Mum. We've been talking about coming to see you for years, haven't we? I know how busy you are, but we had a free week and Bella is off for the holidays, so why not?
Why not indeed? Dad said.
I could think of plenty of reasons, but I held my tongue as Mercy handed them the keys to their room. Before they headed for the stairs, Mum went to catch her familiar, who was having the time of his life batting at the baubles on the tree. Bella surveyed the reception area.
I expected bigger.
We started with zero budget. I tried to keep my tone pleasant. This place was a dilapidated shack when we first moved in.
Sorry, it's not a 5-star hotel.
It seemed my sister still hadn't quite got over her anger at me for taking off and leaving her to handle Mum and Dad and their hat business alone. At the time, I'd been desperate, fearing that if I didn't take the opportunity to get away, I'd be stuck at home forever.
Maybe flying up to the North Pole was a bit much, but it had worked out pretty well for us so far, as our current decor proved. Surely my sister could be the slightest bit happy for me. It was bad enough that Mum and Dad weren't interested in anything which didn't wear a ridiculous hat. As Mum caught Charlie the cat and picked him up, I headed to the staircase to show them to their rooms and spotted Mercy taking the wishing box with her into the back room. Good job, because from the look on my sister's face, she'd already figured out what it was. I'd rather not know what she wanted to wish for, if not to get home as quickly as possible. Why couldn't they have just called me instead? I climbed the short staircase and led my family to their suite, and they carried their bags and suitcases inside. I didn't join in their excited chatter, unable to shake the sinking feeling that I was making a monumental mistake in letting them stay at the inn. It struck me as kind of mean to send them packing when they'd come all this way, but if they'd used magic to get here, then it wouldn't take them that long to get back home either. If I convinced them to leave, it wasn't like I was throwing them out in the cold after all. The wishing box came to mind. Maybe I should give it a test run myself. But if they did stay for the weekend, I'd need more luck than a wishing box could provide to get through it in one piece. Chapter 2. I left my family to settle into their room and returned to the reception area. Mercy, who was in the process of returning the baubles Charlie had knocked off the tree to their former positions, wore an expression which suggested she was almost as baffled as I was at the current turn of events. Neither of us had expected my family to show their faces here at all, let alone without any notice. "I don't even believe this," I whispered to her. "Why are they here?" "I hoped you could tell me that. Didn't you invite them?" I might have suggested they come and stay someday, but I didn't expect them to actually take me up on the offer. Especially at a time like this. "Yeah, I imagine they took it as an invitation," she said. "I know what your parents are like. They were probably only half paying attention." "You aren't wrong." Mum and Dad lived in their own heads most of the time, under the spacious cover of their towering hats. Neither of them was exactly what you'd call grounded. Bella and I had inherited the entirety of the family's common sense. Perhaps it was nature's way of compensating for the two of them having zero attention fixed on the real world. Mercy and I had been best friends since we were 5 years old, so at least I didn't have to explain my weird family to her from scratch. Still, I didn't blame her for being wary about their presence here. Especially considering our first business endeavour, an ice cream shop, had gone down in flames when Bella had decided to replace our caramel with mustard. At the time, Mum and Dad had insisted she didn't know what she was doing since she was only a teenager. As if teenagers couldn't be scheming and vindictive. That particular incident might account for my own wariness over the idea of letting them stay here at the inn throughout the weekend. Maybe I'd be better off convincing them to leave, through direct or indirect means. I hesitated, on the brink of going to look for the wishing box, but before I could slip into the back room, my family re-entered the reception area. At least they'd dressed appropriately for the weather in thick coats, but the sheer brightness of their hats gave Rudolph's shiny nose a run for its money, and their festive cheer would put the local carolers to shame.
"Aren't you going to give us the tour?" Mum asked. "This is such a lovely little town, isn't it?"
"We're kind of busy." On the other hand, letting them roam around town alone might not be a wise idea. Knowing them, they'd end up borrowing a sledge and getting stuck in a snowdrift or something. It was a miracle they'd made it here without getting lost, and I suspected I had Bella to thank for that. Didn't mean she'd be willing to tail them around town and keep an eye on them, though. They didn't just go looking for trouble, they went bounding hat first into it.
"Go on," Mercy said to me. "I'll watch the desk while you go and show them the sights."
Maybe it was a good idea for me to keep my family busy while Mercy took over the business side of things. It wasn't like they could get into too much trouble if I kept an eye on them, right? "Okay, I'll show you around," I said, resigned.
"Fantastic!"
Mum practically skipped with excitement as she followed me out of the inn, while Dad wandered behind her, humming to himself. Bella wore her usual scowl, but she followed us without a fuss. I suspected she'd slip away as soon as my back was turned, but she wasn't the person I needed to watch. Still, if I managed to tire out my parents, I might get a spare moment to use the wishing box to convince them to fly home before the weekend. It'd take a huge weight off my mind and would also enable them to experience the highlights of Holiday Haven without risking jeopardising our event. Win-win. Bolstered by my plan, I took the lead. The group of snow witches Mercy and I had built outside the inn proved a hit, especially when I mentioned that they hadn't melted in all the years they'd sat on either side of the doors with sculpted hats and broomsticks. As we walked through the neighbourhood, Mum and Dad exclaimed and pointed at anything that looked remotely interesting, which was most things, because Holiday Haven did spectacle and style with aplomb. Clusters of carolers sang outside shop windows piled with lovingly wrapped gifts. Sledges sailed past, pulled by huskies and reindeer, and groups of snowmen which never melted sat on street corners. As their excitement refused to abate, I started to wonder if it would even be possible to tire them out. From their back-and-forth conversation, it sounded like they'd already amassed a dozen ideas for new hats they'd create when they got home. Between that and the fact that Dad's hat kept breaking into song, I didn't blame Bella for backing farther and farther away from our group. I couldn't exactly pretend not to be with them since I was their tour guide, so I took them into the confectionery shop, from which they emerged with their jaws gummed shut with delicious warm toffee. Having successfully silenced them for a few minutes, I then took them to the local cafe. Cheery locals wrapped in colourful scarves and warm coats sat in huddles at tables, exchanging the latest gossip. I caught a few words about Jack Frost being missing and something about the local reindeer sanctuary, at least until their attention caught on Mum and Dad's vibrant hats. Luckily, the other customers seemed to find their hats adorable rather than cringeworthy, and we departed with takeaway cups of hot chocolate in hand. I took a long sip, and the warmth went straight to my toes. The local hot chocolate always put me in a good mood, at least until I realised Bella hadn't come inside the cafe. In fact, she was nowhere to be seen. "I think Bella wandered off," I remarked to the others.
"Oh no," said Mum. "What if she's got herself lost?"
"I'm sure she'll be fine," I said. "She's resourceful. Anyway, she might want to explore the town by herself for a bit." "But she doesn't know the way back to the inn, does she?" asked Dad. "She probably remembers," I said. "Besides, everyone here is really friendly. If she asks for directions, she should easily be able to find her way back without any problems." They both looked doubtful, but it wasn't due to lack of faith in Bella. To our parents, my little sister was the baby, and that was doubly true now I'd left home and moved up to the North Pole. I didn't really blame them for being a tad overprotective of her, but I wasn't about to go chasing after Bella when she clearly didn't want to be found. The three of us made our way back through the snowy streets with our hot drinks in our hands and the merry atmosphere of the town staving off the chill of the ever-present snow. I'd almost begun to enjoy myself, if I ignored the fact that my parents were currently debating buying a small mountain of tinsel to make into hats. I let them indulge their curiosity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.